Hello and welcome to the India Hangout. It's football season and we're talking about India and football. The question we're asking is, are we condemned to watch football rather than play? And this, of course, we're picking up the story from those six Goan MLAs who wanted to go to Brazil to watch the football match and obviously not participate in football. The latest news is that they may actually end up paying for their own fare as opposed to the Goan government paying almost 70 lakhs. But that's not the point. The point is larger. Where do we stand in this game and why are we not moving from where we were all these years, at the low point being 169 on the FIFA global ranking as of 2012, and the highest has been 94 in 1996 in the FIFA ranking. The golden period of football, Ayaz, Memon and Abhishek Dubey join us. Ayaz, has been somewhere between 1950 and 1962.
Correct.
Right? So we should be first of all celebrating the golden jubilee of the golden era of football that ended.
Well, we won the Asian Games title in the 50s, and we finished fourth in the Melbourne Olympics. So that was our golden period.
Yeah.
The point is not that. I think the golden period, we have to put it in perspective. That while we were so good then, why have we fallen so far behind?
Right.
When actually most other teams have evolved or at least stayed in the top 20, 15, 20.
Right.
You know,
and not 169.
169 is a steep fall.
Yeah.
And it's not because soccer or football is not popular in India.
Yeah.
Look at Bengal, Kerala, Goa, Punjab. These were all bastions of football till, you know, now it seems like they've all gone to bat and ball, not football.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Okay, Abhishek, why do you think we are condemned to watch this game rather than play it?
Actually, there are a number of factors if it is in the context. India has primarily become a single sports nation, if you'll see. And in 1950, it was way back in 1950, we got an opportunity to participate in the World Cup football by default. But at that point of time, we couldn't participate there. And 64 years down the line, lots of water has flown down the river. And we can see what EPL has done is that it has brought world-class football, quality football in each and every Indian metropolitan drawing room. So we are watching world-class football. We are seeing the stars like Neymar. We are seeing stars like Messi mesmerizing the entire audience on one hand. And on second hand, we have historical pockets of influence, like Portuguese influence in Goa, you can see. In Bengal, there are traditional belts. In Kerala, there are belts. And now in northeastern India. But we must understand one thing. India is a class of aspirational. India is an aspirational society now. This society wants its own Neymar. This society wants its own Messi. And though we are jubilating, seeing the Brazilian score, seeing the Croatian score, seeing the Spanish team score, and mesmerizing the audience, but at one point of time, we feel our players should be there. And this it should be a matter of serious discussion, I feel.
Okay, got it. So we are aspiring, we are aspirational, we want our players to be like these big icons of football, but obviously we've got a long way to go. So Ayaz, I was looking at the All India Football Federation. The president of the federation is Praful Patel.
Yes.
Right? So to me, the problem begins there and perhaps ends there. Right? And there are 11 clubs. Some of those clubs have been incorporated as long back as 1889, Mohan Bagan.
Yes.
East Bengal, 1920, Dempo, 1966. So exactly as Abhishek was doing, talking about the Goa, Bengal, and of course Kerala angle. But if we've been around for so long, why have we not moved up a few notches?
So I think there's not been enough nurturing of football. You know, it's not just about, you know, playing. Look, football is the cheapest game to play. You know, you don't require, at a certain age, you don't even require boots, though one would advocate the use of football shoes. It's the cheapest game to play. It's, you know, you play with your body. You don't even need a hockey stick or a cricket bat or a tennis racket. So it's a very basic fundamental game. You need to know how to run and you need to know how to use your limbs, not your hand preferably. But I think that once you need to go or once you want to go to a higher level, then you need academies, you need serious training. You just don't need passion and fervor because that can fade away if the results are not good enough.
So the All India Football Federation seems to be doing that, and with all these clubs, I mean, the ecosystem seems to exist.
Very factionalized.
Yes.
Very, you know, power struggle driven between the East and the Goan clubs and the Kerala clubs, and Punjab has virtually faded away. There was a time when Punjab was very, very strong.
Okay.
And you know, you don't find many players from Punjab now in the national team. There used to be people from the services who were in the national team. So the national team itself has been, has not made any progress.
So let's ask the cricket question. So how much of this is because cricket occupies so much of mind space, or money, sponsorship, infrastructure and so on, and how much is because we're just not able to focus our minds on a particular thing?
I think that's a very interesting question. It's a very complex question.
Yeah.
In my opinion, if you look at the period, say, between 1920s or 10s, turn of the 20th century when it started, till about 1960-64, all three sports were pretty strong, which is cricket, hockey and football. The following was almost as much. I mean, you could have in a match between Mohammedan Sporting and East Bengal or Mohan Bagan, any of these three big clubs, you would have about 65-70,000 people going and watching that game, much as you would have 80,000 people going and watching a match at the Eden Gardens.
Right.
Likewise in Punjab, in Mumbai, at the Cooperage Stadium, I've seen packed houses, you know. So somewhere hockey and football lost the plot, cricket grabbed the agenda in terms of marketing the sport, catching young people, putting them through their paces, right, and getting the money to support everything.
Right. So, and maybe there's a bit of a chicken and egg question there. So, Abhishek, what's your thought here? So, as Ayaz says, there was a point of time when all three sports were running on even keel, and cricket raced ahead, shot ahead, and hockey and football took a back seat and has never recovered since then.
I think we should begin this with a very basic question. Will we ever see Indian winning 100 meter race in the Olympics? Will we ever see an Indian in the center court of Wimbledon winning the championship over there? Will we ever see an Indian winning Tour de France? Will we ever see India competing for the FIFA World Cup? I think the world has changed a lot, and we cannot call ourselves a football nation. We have, and cricket is not to blame for it. The basic thing is that the cricket is played by a very minuscule minority, and we have been able to somehow dominate that cricket. And BCCI, irrespective of all the follies, should be credited for it. They organize themselves well, from which other sports federations should learn. But the larger question is that it's not what has happened is that we have stagnated with times in other sporting arena, and other nations have advanced by leaps and bounds. We need to catch them. What happened in hockey after the advent of the AstroTurf? We simply lost the plot. So it's a question of bringing in the basic, selecting the basic pockets, and changing the entire sports infrastructure of the country.
So Abhishek, you talked about, you know, will we ever win the 100 meter race or hold the highest track timing for it? Are you saying in some ways that there is a linkage between the nature of that sport and football, or are you saying this is a more administrative country problem?
I'm saying our focus is not properly on sports. And that's why in any serious competition, I feel be it Tour de France, be it 100 meter race, be it participating in the FIFA World Cup, be it Wimbledon, French Open, or whatever it is, they are the pinnacle of sporting glories, and we don't feature at all. Where do we feature? We feature in a game called cricket. It's good. We play cricket. We are two-time world champion. We are 2020 world champion. We are economic powerhouse of that particular sport. But to become a sporting nation, or even to initiate a step in that direction, we need to go a long way. And for that, the basic infrastructure needs to be changed. The basic mindset of the people needs to be changed. That sports is also a serious business. It's not a back of the page story. You do everything and you just do sports as entertainment or for bomb.
Ayaz is going to get in a word in a moment, but Abhishek, even Brazil, for instance, does not have that kind of infrastructure. I mean,
Or that physicality.
I mean, how does that explain? How do you explain Brazil's rise then in this game?
Yeah, it's a very important question, lots of people ask this. They don't have a proper organized system, and they have excelled in this particular arena. If you will see sporting history of many a nation, what has happened is that they, at right point of time, got big sporting heroes, and the youngsters were able to emulate them, and they were able to catch up with the times. That's why they are here. Unfortunately, we don't have any sporting heroes in many of the sports, and that we are lagging behind. But to be a complete sporting nation, to catch up with them, we need to start from the basics. We need to get our fundamentals right, and that is the most important question which I want to raise.
So, I mean, these are very generic kind of solutions. So we can't be a complete sporting nation because each nation has its own kind of passion for a particular sport. Mm-hmm. So in America, you might find that baseball and basketball supersede everything else, including tennis and athletics. They make the big bucks, or boxers make the most money. In England, it's the footballers who make more money than cricket, though cricket also started there. It's the home of cricket. I have no issues with India being a cricketing nation. But I think there are a few things that we haven't done right, which is we haven't tapped the potential. It's not that we never had footballers. We've had some terrific footballers, maybe at a club or national level, who then kind of faded away. We've got terrific badminton players because suddenly the badminton federation or association woke up to talent and said, let's send them out for international competition. I mean, Saina Nehwal has come across, Prakash Padukone. We've had Mary Kom, the boxer, coming from the Northeast. We've started looking into areas where we never looked earlier. So I think that is happening. I think also as a country, once we get plugged in into the global society, we'll realize that being good at sports also makes you a soft power.
Right. So we've
and there's
been
a sense of pride, and there's also livelihood coming in.
Sure.
It was never, you and I, when we were growing up, we were told to study and not play sports because if you don't pass your exam, you may not get a job.
Sure. But having said that, I mean, you know, we've been plugged in now as a country. I'm saying, if for someone who was, let's say, started, you know, whatever, looking on the internet, satellite TV, 15 years has passed since that era has come upon us. So for someone to have been influenced as a youngster and actually get into the game and reach somewhere by the age of 18, which is a reasonable point of time, should have happened by now.
Yes, I think what's happening, and this is interesting, is that a lot of Latin American talent would be exploited by clubs in Europe. They would go to talent scouts. Like in cricket, the talent scouts from county cricket would go to the Caribbean islands earlier. They would spot a Viv Richards and take him to Somerset. So now, clubs, because India is also an emerging economic superpower, and 125 crore, they want to tap into India for all its, you know, opportunities it offers.
So you're saying there is, there is a tipping point
I think emerging,
where
young kids from India will go and be absorbed in those clubs. Like Messi, he's lived all his life in Spain, though he's from Argentina.
Right. Okay. So Abhishek, do you concur with that we may be at a tipping point of sorts in terms of talent coming in, and because of all these other forces like scouts and infrastructure and so on?
As I told you, it's aspirational India. But like, if quality football or quality game, any game, is coming to the drawing room, we aspire to be there. And that's why this league culture has started in, where the India Super League venture is starting and all those stuff is starting. But what I'm repeatedly emphasizing is that we need to change the mindset of the nation if we want to compete at the various serious level. And we do have an opportunity. Because, see, the FIFA World Cup is played in Brazil this time. But the ironical part is that the most popular sporting tournament of the world, globe, didn't have two of the most popular nations, that is China and India. So they also feel that India is a big catchment area. Likewise, hockey, traditional international hockey, they have realized that if they want the game to prosper, they want India to do well. So other organizations are looking at us, and we have an opening in that direction. But we need to catch up the trend, and we have miles to go before we sleep in this direction, I think.
Ayaz, the aspiration is a given. The youth is a given. The fact that they are exposed to all of this is a given. Let's talk for a second. I mean, one doesn't want to spend too much time on government and government related stuff, but the fact is that you have an All India Football Federation, the president of which is a politician. At this point of time, he does not even have a parliamentary position. I'm assuming Praful Patel is still the president.
Yes.
Right. So what does that tell you, and what does that even, I mean, why would that give anyone hope? I mean, if this is really being run as a political.
So I think one of the it's a malaise in Indian society, so to speak, because
including in cricket,
you look at every sports federation is headed by a politician. So before Praful Patel, there was Priya Ranjan Das Munshi.
Sure.
So, you know, cricket was till recently headed by either Sharad Pawar or somebody else, or they are involved in some other way. Likewise, hockey, you'll find that politicians get in. Kabaddi, Kho Kho, you name the sport, they are there. It gave them a kind of a hold on mass appeal, or whatever, for whatever reason, or just the power. I think that is also changing. I think there's a there's a constant demand for delivery. Mm. Either you deliver or you don't. I also think where politicians have been of some help is that they would get clearances for infra far more easily than somebody else.
But do they need to be sitting in a federation
They don't need to be doing that. So I think that's the big change that's coming up. Mm. Look, I think we are, you know, we must lament, Abhishek is doing it, that we are a country of 125 crore, not a sporting nation. The mindset needs to change. Hopefully now they're saying every Sunday will be sports day in schools. Mm. So that will kind of trigger off something. I think that we need to invite a lot more participation of women in sports, because the women of today are the mothers of tomorrow.
Yeah.
And now once they inculcate the sporting instinct in them, the kids go out and play.
Yeah.
So I think a lot is happening. Look, in chess, we are extremely good. In shooting, we are very good. In badminton, we are amongst the few nations which have really progressed very well.
Mm-hmm.
In boxing, we are not doing too badly. So I buy the idea from Abhishek. Maybe for starters, you need to focus on a few disciplines, few sports, get good in them.
But Ayaz, football. Did we focus, when we say we, the country at large, the government in power and so on, or is it because a bunch of young people took their own initiative, maybe worked in a local academy?
It's absolutely the latter. I think you've produced champions despite or in spite of the system.
Yeah, it's almost like the Indian IT industry.
Barring cricket.
Yeah.
I think in cricket, it's got very streamlined with all the kind of, you know, pitfalls or problems we see in the BCCI. I think they've done a very good job. They have assumed the role of custodian of the game, not just in India, but globally now.
Right.
And they've done everything to try and nurture it. They've had their own internal issues.
Sure.
But that's a different, you know, matter altogether. I think in the case of football, there have been lots of tug of wars between the administrators. So soccer has suffered, football has suffered, like hockey. Till recently, you've had two factions ruling hockey.
Hmm.
Now, you know, players are saying, main idhar jaun ya udhar jaun. And that's not a happy state of mind to be in.
Right. Okay, Abhishek, the question on politics, I mean, should politicians be involved with the All India Football Federation? Is this another reason why a sport, in this case football, is not taking off and surely hasn't taken off for the last 50 years?
See, if you will see this, Ayaz raised a very pertinent point. If we go and talk to any organization, we used to raise this issue with many politicians at that point of time, because literally, I think every second federation is headed by a politician. And the cryptic answer was that, you see, we need to get the things done. And the politician is the best way through which we can get the thing done. Ultimately, what we need to understand is that sports is a high money business. You need to pump in money and lots of money if you want to improve the infrastructure, grow the players, provide them best of the trainings and exposure. And for that, what is very important is that the corporate funding is very important. We need to ensure that. This is where I see a silver lining post-IPL revolution. Because what is happening is that because of the success of IPL, other sports are coming up there with their own leagues, and the corporate participation is increasing. Now, the onus lies on the government. Fortunately, the new government, the Modi government, which has come there, they are starting many, path-breaking steps in different areas. And sports is a field they should look up to and involve someone like Ayaz Menon or people like them. They should be there in the advisorial capacity. Their expertise, their experience should be utilized by the new government. Like there is a health policy, there should be a sports policy. And why not to frame this policy right from the scratch? So these things need to be harped on and emphasized, I feel.
Comment from Ashutosh. He says, not just the mindset, please change the people who run football and get professionals only.
I think that's a very valid point. I think it precedes the mindset because in the current scenario, you want to kick off something which is going to be changed, cataclysmic.
Kick off is a pun intended.
Yes. So mindset changes over a longer period of time, but these are administrative measures that can be put through immediately. Just a point to make, Govind, I think we can be very harsh, as we should be, in examining ourselves and our own system, but we must also acknowledge that we were a very poor country. So resources in terms of money.
I recall reading that the 1950 Cup, we could not participate in because we couldn't afford to go there.
We couldn't afford
one of the
there.
Reasons at least.
So it does not explain away the decline in hockey or football. I think that, and we've depended on government largesse. The sports ministry would dole out some money, to the federations. The federation officials would say, thoda paisa aa gaya, power aa gaya. They would make, you know, better use of that money than the players. That is changing. I think more disposable income, a greater GDP, so to speak, is going to make us pursue sports and lifestyle pursuits far more.
Because, I mean, we have to remember, football, if I recall correctly, is the second most watched sport in India.
Yes, it is.
Yes, right.
It is.
So it's not incorrect or
and
improper
even played.
To yeah, and played. So therefore, it's not unusual to ask or incorrect to ask why this we don't have a more organized presence in this game.
Globally, if you look at sports, how it's kind of prospered or how people have got into excellence is either there's a lot of resources available, training, expertise, camps, etc., which costs a lot of money, or it should be in your DNA. Like you've seen a lot of African countries, they produce great sprinters or milers or whatever. Jamaica has produced great sprinters. Mm. Like they produce great cricketers, but they haven't produced great footballers.
Okay.
For some reason, though they do play football or hockey players. So every country can't excel in every sport. But for a sporting country, the mindset, as Abhishek said, and we've all agreed, needs to change. So you appreciate sport. And it can't be a unidimensional sporting country. Mm. There will be other sports also which flourish enough to afford people to get in.
Right. So let's revisit the last question as we, the original question as we close, Abhishek. What's the, are we condemned to watch football rather than play it? Your last word on this.
See, for the next 30 years, I will say yes. And 30 years is a reasonably shorter time that I am saying. Because the level of the competition, one should be very, very honest and see as to what is the difference. There is a huge gulf. And I just want to make a correction. We were saying initially in 1950, we got an opportunity to participate in the FIFA World Cup. What happened at that point of time is that the first All India Football Federation said, we don't have money. The organizer said, we are willing to fund. You come here. Then we said, we don't have time to practice. We have other priorities. And somehow, we didn't go there. So when we are going to get the next chance, it's difficult to say now. But there is, as I said, miles and miles to go before we sleep, before reaching that international standard.
Right. There's a shortcut.
Abhishek. Yes.
There's a shortcut.
Okay, go
to
ahead.
To be playing in the World Cup football,
yeah.
You host it.
Okay.
The host country gets automatic entry.
Right.
So 2024,
but we're seeing what's happening in Brazil, right? I mean, the entire, not entire, but the population is on the streets protesting.
No, I'm saying, but we can play.
Yeah.
World Cup,
yeah.
if you host it, so maybe that's a good starting point. Host the World Cup.
Yeah, we Indians can always come up with good shots.
We can come up with jugaad.
Right, that's all we have time for in this edition of Hangout. We're going to be back next week. Thanks for watching.